If you have your Bibles, turn with me to 2 Thessalonians chapter 1 is where we're going to teach out of today. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1. We were in 1 Thessalonians about 10 weeks ago. We wrapped up that study of that book of the Bible, jumped into the book of Micah, and now we are in 2 Thessalonians. And by the grace of God and his provision, 6.5 years now since we started corporately worshiping together and gathering in community groups together, God's allowed us to be able to be subjected to every book of the Bible through our small group time or through the preaching of His Word. And so very excited to wrap up 2 Thessalonians, which is kind of that last book that we've not intentionally subjected our people with. Realizing that, hey, I know that we didn't all remember every one of those books that we went through, and but that's okay. The discipline is to continue to subject ourselves to all of God's Word, to the whole counsel of God's Word. And so that's why we're mainly purposely in this passage of Scripture, is because we're coming on a new year, and we want to finish looking through every window of the Bible that views us a little bit better into the character of who our God is. Amen? That's what these books of the Bibles are, windows into the character of God. And as we study each window, we know a little bit more about the God who loves us, who's there for us. And so we're going to be about 3 weeks, hopefully, in 2 Thessalonians. So that's 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, 1 through 12. Please stand with me as we read the Word of God together in honor of the reading of the Word of God. Not till lunchtime, right? You know, we won't stand. Noon to daybreak, just for a few moments. All right, here we go. Paul, Silvanus, and Timothy, to the Church of the Thessalonians and God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. We must always thank God for you, brothers. This is right, since your faith is flourishing and the love each one of you has for one another is increasing. Therefore, we ourselves boast about you among God's churches, about your endurance and faith in all the persecutions and afflictions you endure. It is clear evidence of God's righteous judgment that you will be counted worthy of God's kingdom, for which you also are suffering, since it is righteous for God to repay with affliction those who afflict you, and to reward with the rest of you who are afflicted along with us. This will take place at the revelation of the Lord Jesus from heaven with his powerful angels, taking vengeance with flaming fire on those who don't know God and on those who don't obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus. These will pay the penalty of eternal destruction from the Lord's presence and from his glorious strength. And in that day, when he comes to be glorified by his saints and to be admired by all those who believed, because our testimony among you was believed. And in view of this, we always pray for you that our God will consider you worthy of his calling and will by his power fulfill every desire for goodness and the work of faith, so that the name of our Lord Jesus will be glorified by you and you by him, according to the grace of God and our Lord Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Dear Jesus, I just thank you for this second service today, God, and I do pray as we have read your word now and we begin to teach from it. The Holy Spirit, you will guide my words and my thoughts, and that, God, it will be edifying to your church, and that, God, it will be glorifying to you, and that, God, you will use it to help us be obedient and worship you, Lord Jesus. We love you and just thank you for allowing us to be able to be in an environment where we can study God's word. And, God, help that always to be a priority of our heart, Lord, to know you more through your word. Jesus, thank you. Amen. All right, here's the sermon title up here today on the screen. Or I guess it will be. Just say, there it is. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 1 through 12. God's judgment and glory. This is for you note takers, okay? You know, in my Holman Christian Standard Bible version, the title for the text was God's judgment and glory, you know. And so when you prepare for messages, you know, you study hard you're ready. And then that final thing is that cherry on top. You just want to have that great little sermon title that goes along with it. And man, throughout this week as I studied, I couldn't grab hold of that sermon title. So I'm like, well, here's what we got. You got me? Here's what the text. I had two choices, greeting or God's judgment and glory, okay? And so since the main guts of it is from that text, we are going to look at God's judgment, his faithfulness to watch over his believers who are going through persecution, and his judgment on those who are persecuting them. But it's going to end up and wrap up with the glory of God. So this is where we're studying today. I want to throw these verses up to you in case you want to take a picture of them with your phone or write them down for you note takers. We're going to allude to these today, but Romans 8:15, Romans 10:9, Ephesians 2:4-5, Romans 5:1, 1 Thessalonians 3:11 through 13, 1 Timothy 3:12, Romans 1:18 through 20, and Romans 3:10 through 12, Romans 10:17, and 1 Corinthians 15:1-8. As we study through this text, we're going to allude to these passages of Scripture that point out these truths and principles that we're bringing out today. Okay? So let's get started. Chapter 1, verse 1. Paul, Silvanus, many of us know him as Silas. Paul, Silas, and Timothy, to the church of the Thessalonians and God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. We'll stop right there, and we want to take note of the introduction. Okay? I do not believe that any word is flippant used in the Bible. It has a purpose, it has a process, and there's a danger in trying to read too much into things, but at the same time, there's a danger in just glossing over and reading over things and not paying attention to what's been shared. So I want to attempt to share that with you today. Paul introduces himself. He says, Paul, Silas, and Timothy. And if you go back and you look at every letter that Paul wrote, Paul's always introducing himself, and most of the time, he's introducing other people with him. Silas and Timothy are kind of like his proteges. He had another one that we refer up to as Titus. Silas and Timothy, they would journey with Paul as he went to plant churches, as he would go back to check on churches. They would accompany him in that. And so when he wrote letters back to them, these guys were with him. And so he would let them know, here's the guys that are with me. Silas and Timothy. Paul always had someone with him. Why? Well, here's an application, folks. Discipleship is a key tool to kingdom growth for the glory of God. Discipleship is key. And we should ask ourselves this question today. If we're a faithful follower of Jesus and we've been walking with God, who are we bringing alongside with us to help them know God better and to partner with us in the ministry that God's called us to? Because the Great Commission says that we're not only to make disciples, but to teach them also to obey everything I've commanded you. We should have people in our life that as we teach the Word of God, we're able to see by practice and sharing life together if they're catching it. And then Paul couldn't see this in any other way than to say, hey, I can't do a seminar on church planting. I can't write a book and tell you this is how it looks. All I can tell you is come with me. Same thing, Andrew asked Jesus, where you're going? Jesus says, why don't you come find out? And Andrew went with Jesus. Jesus ministered to the crowds. Jesus ministered to the stranger. Jesus did the work that God told him to do. And Jesus climbed on a cross for our sins, rose from a grave. But for 3 years, he invested in 12 men. And these 12 men still wasn't getting it to the end of his time, okay? But he invested, and some would say he invested even more into three, and even some would say even to one. But he brought people along the journey. Church, here's the first thing I want to challenge us with as we study God's Word. It's in the DNA of the New Testament church in Scripture, and it should be in the DNA here at Bridge Community Church, that we are to be a people that are committed to discipling one another. And that we take people under our wing and we walk together in discipleship. And friend, if you have been walking with Jesus faithfully, you've got something to offer back to someone behind you. There's always someone younger on the journey than you. Guess what? There's also someone always older. And those sovereign intersections that God gives us, where you pull up to this intersection and someone pulls up on the other side. Seize those moments and the people God are putting in your life for the season that you're in to teach you. Because great kingdom growth has got to go beyond our own life. Amen? It's got to go beyond what we can see. And Paul got that. Paul says, I'm not going to be able to go back forever to all these churches. And so what did he have? Silas and Timothy with him. We've got to be a part of that church. I am excited about this new chapter in Bridge Community. I'm excited about the things that are coming in place, and I want to allude to some of that a little bit later in the message today. But one direction we're heading is an intentional discipleship process here at Bridge Community, okay? Where we are helping, as John described them in John chapter 2, helping those children of the faith who understand their salvation to now grow as young men, overcoming the evil one, and then grow into elders, knowing the intimate walk with God. We want to see progress for all. Why? Because Ephesians 4 said this is what we're called to, that we all will be equipped in ministry so that we will all be encouraged and be to the mutual faith together. Folks, we're all supposed to be there, okay? You see that testimony already in Paul's life. Let's keep going. He then says to the church of the Thessalonians, in God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. In his introduction, you see the intimacy and the intentionality that describes the church. He just is talking to, he says, hey, I'm talking to you folks, you church of Thessalonians, but I'm talking to you specifically using some specific words. My introduction of my letter to you is, first of all, letting you know who you are. And the two things that you need to know in my intro to you that I'm writing to is this: intimacy and intentionality. Look at it. To the church of Thessalonians, in God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. We're not just here to gather today together to worship a God that is disconnected from us, that one day we long to get to meet and talk to, as long as we give plenty of sacrifices that please Him and kind of keep away His wrath. That's not the God that we serve. We don't serve a God who looks at us like a slave or a servant and say, go do this for me or go do this for me. We serve a God who has said, although I can make the mountains tremble and although I can make them fall like wax and melt like wax, I have chosen by my sovereignty and by my goodness, I have chosen to make you my child. Nothing. Let me repeat that. Okay? The God who created the mountains, that when He stands before them, the Word of God says in Psalms 97, they can melt like wax. Okay? That's a big mountain. That's a bigger God. He can make a mountain melt like wax. What can He do with me? That God has said, I don't want you trembling in front of me. I don't want you in fear in front of me. I want you to be with me. Yeah, there you go. That's better. Romans chapter 8. Look at it. Romans 8. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you received the spirit of adoption by whom we cry out, Abba, Father. You are not a slave. You are not a servant, church. Good morning. Glad you're here to worship our great, awesome God. Why is He awesome? Because not only is He awesome just by His mere presence and making everything fall back, this God of the universe has said, you are my beloved, you are my child, and I'm going to put within you a spirit that actually can call me daddy. That's cool. All right? That's glorious. And so, friends, when the church is described by Paul, it's described with intimacy. We're able to be known as intimate with God, that we're able to call Him Abba, Father. But the intro of the church is not only to God our Father, it's also to the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the intentionality of the church. Look at Romans chapter 10. on the screen with me. If you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Now let's go back and read that again. If you confess with your mouth Jesus is Savior and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Is that what we said? No. Scripture says, if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord. Paul says in 2 Thessalonians, to you, the church, in God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Romans 10, same writer, Paul says that if you confess your mouth, Jesus is Lord, you shall be saved. What's the intentionality of the church? Friends, it's not good enough to know Jesus is Savior. That's not what labels you, church. Many in this world, even the demons themselves, can declare Jesus as Savior. There's something even more intentional about us that labels us the church and why we are what we are. That intentionality is we have submitted and yielded to the Lordship of Jesus Christ in our life. You just knowing Jesus as Savior is not enough to save you according to the Scriptures. You must have the confession of Him as Lord of your life. He's the boss. Lordship's used over 600 times compared to Savior, which is used 60 in the Bible. Which do you think Jesus has more of an emphatic interest in? You knowing Him as a Savior or you knowing Him as Lord? Do you know Jesus as Lord? That is the label of the church. An intimate label where God is our Father. But an intentional label of just a head knowledge, knowing that He did something for me, is not enough. But an intentional laying down of my life and denying myself and taking up my cross and following Him because I believe He is who He says He is. That's what it means to believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead. He is everything He said He did. What He said He was going to do, He did it. I believe it. That settles it. He's God. Therefore, I follow Him. Is Jesus Lord of your life? I didn't ask you if you know Him as a Savior. I'm asking, do you know Him as the one who calls the shots in your life? Do you listen to His voice and do you respond in obedience? Because the Word of God says, my Father will love those who love me, and you love me when you obey my commands. My sheep hear my voice. Many people in this community want someone to take care of their sins, but they don't want that same person telling them what to do with their life. That is the false gospel that is being preached in our churches, in our communities, and even sometimes in crusades around this area. That you've messed up and you need somebody to clean up your mess, just ask Jesus to come in your heart because He will save you from your sins. But they never talk about the Lordship of Jesus Christ. Be careful in these days, church. Are we hearing the true gospel? Those who confess you as Lord shall be saved. Our label is an intimate and intentional label. We have an intimacy with God, the Creator, that the mountains don't have. Amen? And we're set apart because of an intentional commitment that came from our heart of faith. When Christ and the gospel message of Jesus initiated that message into our heart, we respond in abandonment to ourselves and the denial of self, and we take up our cross and we follow Jesus. The demons know He saves. The demons know He saves. Do you know Jesus as Lord? Let's keep going. Verse 2, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Once again, we'll see this as just a welcome greeting, and we'll move right into verses 3 through 7 without ever letting these two words magnify in our heart. Paul starts out in many of his letters, grace and peace or mercy, and he mentions these constantly. Grace and peace, grace and peace. Why does he mention these? Because, friends, this is how we need to start out our day in our prayer life. This is our confidence and this is our banner when we walk in these doors. Like we talked about last week, we have bad days, amen? We have days we fail, right? I mean, I don't know about you, but I can get so prideful about my spiritual discipline and obedience to my quiet time. Man, I can rattle off a whole good week of just meeting with Jesus and his angels, you know, 7 days in a row, and then I'll let a thought come in my mind and say, man, I had a good week. I met with Jesus every day. And then God kind of laughs and says, yeah, we'll see how powerful Chris is. And he throws a wrench into my schedule like Thanksgiving holidays. And the school's audacity to let my kids stay home from school, right? And it wrecks my world. You know, it wrecks my world. I wasn't as disciplined and faithful and holy as I thought I was. So what gives me confidence on those days? What gives me the confidence that I can still come and kneel before a loving God who is delighting to come, for me to come before him and worship him? How do I not know that when I come to God, he's going to say, like, what are you creeping up here for? You weren't faithful to me yet today like you were yesterday. You didn't talk to as many people about Jesus today as you did yesterday. You didn't really like me as much today, Chris. What makes us be able to walk in these doors today instead of retreat with this manipulation? Satan does this to us. Oh, you're not good enough to be here today, so don't be a hypocrite. Don't walk in here. Right? We do it. We're appreciative of the character in your heart that you don't want to be a liar and a manipulator, but Satan then will trick us to isolate us from the fellowship. No, you're a hypocrite. I'll be walking in. What gives us the confidence? You know what? God is still delighted about me walking in here today with his people to worship. What gives us that? Guys, these words. These words that Paul's introducing to the church. Grace and peace. Grace and peace to you. He's like setting the stage saying, hey, this is what's letting all of us gather together here today. It wasn't that you shared Jesus and you didn't, so you sit over here and you sit here. No, to all of you, grace and peace. That's why we're here. That's why we're here. So let's slow down and look at these words, grace and peace. Grace, God's favor in us through Jesus Christ. What is grace? It is the favor of God, the unmerited favor of God in your life through his son Jesus. It is God. And folks, I don't get it. I still don't get it. That's why it's called amazing, okay? It is the God of the universe who I can deny 3 times today that will look at me with the same affection and favor that he would if I led 3 people to Christ. That's the favor we're talking about. My works don't dictate his favor. It's his favor. Bestowed to me, given to me, through his son Jesus. So good news, church, grace to you today. Amen? Let's look at it, Ephesians chapter 2, verses 4 through 5. Ephesians 2, 4 through 5 is the spiritual resume of the church. Chapter 2, verses 1 through 10 is the spiritual resume. And it goes to the first part of where we were before Christ. And then 4 and 5 is the middle portion, the good stuff, what changes our life. And it says this, but God, who is rich in mercy, because of his great love that he had for us, made us alive with the Messiah. Even though we were dead in trespasses, you are saved by grace. Friend, how much potential does a dead guy have? He's worm food. That's about it. Okay? That's his lot in life. But there's not much potential for a dead person. So my friend, what was it about your potential that God saw when he chose to save your life? You were dead. It's by his great mercy, his incredible love, that he says, I'm going to change this enemy to a son. I'm going to replace my wrath with my favor. And it's called grace. And when you get it, it compels you to live and scream back, I love you. Let me be where you are. So, church, grace to you today. That's what's qualified you to be here today. Grace. There's another word, peace. And if you look back up on the board there, peace. The war with God is over. Now, I know we might want to make it more practical to our everyday life of, oh, when we get anxious and we get nervous, we want that peace that passes all understanding, and we want to pray for just a calm perspective for our self-absorbed worlds of making it about me and making my day good, okay? But if we want to be a gospel-centered church, a gospel-centered follower of Christ, then when we see the word peace, that needs to be a discipline in our heart that we go back to the very first, most important peace that was ever established for you and me. The fact that you were once an enemy desiring to walk with the evils of this world, and God chose by his grace to save your life. Therefore, wrath was replaced with his favor and love for you. Therefore, according to Romans chapter 5, verse 1, by what Christ has now done for you, there has been peace made with you and God. Therefore, since we have been declared righteous by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Church, grace and peace to you. Number one, he loves you no matter what you did for him. He loves you. Number two, peace to you. He's not out to get you. You're going to see in these verses, he's out to get some people in a moment. But you're not one of them. That's awesome. I have peace with God. That is so much better than whether or not God calmed my nerves right before a job interview. Me knowing that I'm at peace with the God who could cast me into the lake of fire is so much more refreshing than, oh God, just get me through this 5 minutes before I ask this girl out for a date. Come on, y'all. Let's get back to a gospel-centered focus. I don't care if we have all those other pieces, amen? I got that piece. Now we do care about them. And God does meet us with them, because why? He favors us. He loves us. But when you hear grace and peace, my friend, remember this. The war is over. And you're not a conquered foe. You're family. He conquered you to make you family. That's awesome. Let's go on. Verse 3. We must always thank God for you, brothers. This is right, since your faith is flourishing and the love each one of you has for one another is increasing. Verse 4. Therefore, we ourselves boast about you among God's churches, about your endurance and faith in all the persecutions and afflictions you endure. Paul's next words, after he establishes their identity, after he tells them the conditions on which we stand, he says this next to you. Props to you. Praise God, what's going on in your life. Before we get to talking about everything else that needs to be talked about in our conversation, says Paul, let me talk to you first of all about the faithfulness of what I see God doing in your life. Let's talk about the goodness of God. And so verse 3 says, I thank God for the faith and the love that I see in you. And I want to talk about that for a moment. I want to praise God. Why? Because he prayed for that in 1 Thessalonians. Chapter 3, verse 12. Let's look at it. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. And may the Lord cause you to increase and overflow with love for one another and for everyone, just as we also do for you. He shared in his first prayer, man, I'm praying that you guys will grow in love and grow in faith. A few months later, he gets a report back saying they're doing that. So what does he do? He thanks God. And he takes a moment to testify, and he says this in verse 3. This is right, meaning that I'm seeing this. I'm seeing the testimony of God in your life. So I want to thank God for it. Folks, we need to realize that when we share testimony, that's showing our gratitude and thanksgiving to what God has done. Not what we've done, but what God's done. And that's why there needs to be testimony in the church. There's a lot of important things that Paul needs to get to before he starts dealing with the future things. He reflects back on the past of God's faithfulness, and he gives props to God and says, God, you're awesome. I see you doing this work in them, and I just want to take a moment to thank you, Lord, and worship you. Friends, before we start asking God to supply for our needs in our prayer life, we need to begin looking back on God's faithfulness in our life already. Before we start saying, God, help be faithful in this area, we need to recount the timeless times that he has already been faithful to us in so many ways, and we need to give thanksgiving to that. So, Dusty, go ahead and show that next thing on the slide I want to show here. Your testimony is your expression of thanksgiving to God. Individually, church, are you thanking God in your prayer life for the victory in your life and what you see in others? Before you start praying for God to supply something else, would you thank him for what he supplied yesterday? And would you take a moment to just let the Holy Spirit recall in your heart the many ways that you've seen his faithfulness already? Paul doesn't go on in his letter until he first looks back and thanks God for what he's already seen him do. Guys, we need to do the same in our practice. And this, they call 2 Thessalonians a pastoral letter. He gives them application, and I'm going to give us application today. At Bridge, we need to do this more. Before we move on to the next project or to the next mission or the next task, we need to reflect back on God's faithfulness, and we need to give props to God for what we see him doing in people's lives and in ministries in this church. That's a form of worship to our Lord. So here's what's going to happen next Sunday. Here's what I hope will start happening this Tuesday and Wednesday night in community groups. I pray we'll start seeing our student and our children's ministries. I pray we'll see it in our Sunday night groups when they start back next week. And we're going to lead the way next Sunday morning. Every Sunday morning, if we're going to create any traditions here at Bridge Community Church, we're going to start giving 3 to 5 minutes for somebody in this church who's a member of this church coming and testifying to God's faithfulness in their life or in the ministry of what they see God doing through one of the ministries of Bridge. Why? Because if we're not careful, we can lose sight of the provider. And we need to be a grateful people for what he's already done. Our men's ministry was challenged a couple weeks ago. What if we only thank God? What if we only were given what we thank God for yesterday? What if we were only given today what we thank God for yesterday? So every Sunday, we're going to have somebody share testimony of what they've seen the goodness of God do in their life or in the life of a ministry, so that we can give props to God, so that gratitude and thanksgiving can be in another intentional way when we come corporately to worship. And community group leaders, when you have your prayer and share time, before you begin with request, would you be disciplined enough to say, can anybody testify to God's faithfulness this past week? Can anybody share how God has been faithful this past week in your life? Would you be willing to do that, leaders? It was in the DNA of the church to be a grateful people, and there was testimony about God's faithfulness in their life. Not props to the Thessalonians, but props of God working in their life. We need to be that type of people as well. Amen? All right. So, love and faithfulness were what we're oozing out. faithfulness and devotion, faithfulness and love, that's what was oozing out in them. And we're not going to camp out on that too long, but I will want to say this, folks. Those are two measuring scales of a healthy church. How are we leaning in on God more and more every year? Leaning less on self and more on God. That's a true measuring scale of a healthy church. Number two is, how are we loving one another? How are we loving one another is a sign of a healthy church. And those of you who have ever done counseling with us, we talk about the five love languages in a marriage or in a relationship. Gifts, acts of service, words of affirmation, physical touch, quality time. And the key component of that is that when we love one another, we're to love as the recipient of that love would want to be loved. Not us love in a conditional way of how we want to show love, but how that person needs that love. And so Paul is commenting and saying, you guys are showing healthiness and you're leaning in on Jesus and depending in on him, and you are showing love for one another. And so I just want to ask that to us today as a church. It's not about what's your love language. It's about the person that God's put in your line of fire. What is their love language, and how do you need to be loving that person? Do they need a hug? Do they just need your time? Church, one of the best ways that we could show love is if we could slow down and quit adding more to the plate and give more time to people. Will we serve people? Serving is a privilege. Not serving the way we want to serve, but hey, it might be service as in, hey man, we got a bunch of children up here and we do need your help on Sunday night when we call you. To love a kid, and no, that might not be your passion, but yeah, we need that. That may not be the way you want to show love, but that's how you show love to that need. That's the true measuring scale of a healthy church, our faithfulness and our love. Let's keep going. Verse 4. Therefore, we ourselves boast about you among God's churches, about your endurance and faith in all the persecutions and afflictions you endure. It is clear evidence of God's righteous judgment that you will be counted worthy of God's kingdom, for which you also are suffering, since it is righteous for God to repay with affliction those who afflict you and to reward with rest you who are afflicted along with us. Paul's saying, I'm bragging about you because of your faithfulness while you're going through persecution. You're dealing with persecution right now and it's hurting you. It's terrible. And I'm writing to you to encourage you to keep going on because you've identified yourself with Christ, Jesus. And as Jesus was persecuted in the world, you have chosen to follow Jesus. Therefore, you're going to be persecuted in this world. Hang in there. Friends, 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 12 says this, that if we desire to live a godly life, we will be persecuted. 2 Timothy 3, verse 12. It does not say that if we desire to live a godly life, there is the percentage chance that you might be persecuted if you do this. It says, if we desire the godly life, we will be persecuted. What's the application here before we go further? Persecution is a part of the package when it comes to pursuing Jesus. Persecution is a part of the package when it comes to pursuing Jesus. So here's your question. Where's the persecution in my life? Friends, 2 Timothy 3 verse 12 cannot be taken out of the Bible. It wasn't for a certain select people. It was for all those who desired to live a godly life. You will be persecuted. Now, before I move on, let me say this. I'm not talking about your screw-ups that cause adversity in your life. We've already talked about that when we talked about grace. Amen? We're talking about a different matter. We're talking about what these Thessalonians were experiencing. The enemy of God and all his evil forces. And the people that was with him, human beings, attacking the church. Ridiculing, mocking, putting them in jail. There's a guy named Jason that just because he was affiliated with Paul, got drug out of his house and thrown into jail. We're talking about that type of persecution. And what challenges my heart is that question. If this is not an option, but it is part of the DNA of the church, then where's the persecution in my life? And if it's not there, and you can't look back on your life and point to scenes and episodes when it was there, the Word of God doesn't tell us how frequently it comes. It doesn't tell us when we can dictate when it's going to happen. It just says it's a part of the journey. My friend, if you cannot look back on your journey with Christ and see scenes and moments of persecution, then you got to ask yourself, am I actually on the journey with Christ? Am I actually? We're not talking about your screw-ups and the stupid things you did to get yourself in a mess. That's grace, right? We're talking about I'm pursuing Jesus, I'm following Jesus, and the enemy is coming at me to derail me from Jesus. And if you can't look back on your life and see scenes and moments of that, you got to ask yourself the question, have you really been pursuing Jesus at all? Because the Word of God says that you will be persecuted. Could there be leeway for our little kids right now that are just coming into a knowledge of God's Word? Yes. But the testing of whether or not that salvation's real will be when they get made fun of at school when they stand up for Jesus. Will they back down or will they not? When they get mocked, ridiculed. Y'all feeling me? This is something that I have to personally get down quiet before God and say, Lord, remove all pride. Lord, why is there not more persecution in my life? I don't want it. Amen? Yeah. Let's go get our butt beat. No. Who wants that? It's not fun. It hurts. Hurts worse when other people are taking the brunt of your obedience. That hurts worse than ever. And sometimes when you step out on obedience, Satan doesn't have enough backbone to come try to punch you in the face. He punches everybody else around you in the face to make you weak. That stinks. But friends, this isn't an option. Paul's writing to him saying, man, keep going. I'm not writing to you to say, hey, here's how you get out of this, because God has provided ways for us to get out of persecution, and I'm here to share those with you so that you can avoid them again. No, it's happening. Stay faithful, stay true, stay on it, guys. If you can't look back on your walk, adult Christian, teenage Christian, if you cannot look back on your walk and the Holy Spirit give you recall of moments of persecution, of ridicule, then for the glory of God and by the Spirit of God with humility, will you at least ask him why and listen to him? Because it may be you've never been on the road to begin with. Y'all ready to move on, aren't you? All right, let's do it. Me too. Verse 6, since it's righteous for God to repay with affliction those who afflict you, and to reward with rest you who are afflicted along with us, This will take place at the revelation of the Lord Jesus from heaven with his powerful angels, taking vengeance with flaming fire on those who don't know God and on those who don't obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus. These will pay the penalty of eternal destruction from the Lord's presence and from his glorious strength. And in that day, when he comes to be glorified by his saints and be admired by all those who have believed because of our testimony among you was believed. Paul says, hey, I don't have news that you're getting out of this. Hang in there. God's keeping an eye on it. And here's the hope I want to give you. You're going through persecution right now, but there's a day coming that God will avenge his people. I mean, there's no avenger like Jesus, okay? I mean, Hulk's pretty good, incredible, amen? But he's not Jesus, okay? Jesus is the great avenger. And there is a day coming that he will avenge for his glory those who have persecuted his people, his children. Daddy will show up. Amen? Daddy is going to clean house. And the Word of God shows us here, and it goes on in other passages of Scripture to describe that when Jesus comes back with all his angels, it is going to be a horrific moment for many people. All those that walked away or those that didn't obey the Word of God, and we'll get to this in a moment, but the enemies of God, they will be judged. And friends, we're not talking about just hell, dying and going to hell. We're saying that this judgment, even hell itself is going to be picked up and thrown into a lake of fire. It's going to get worse than what people who are in hell right now are experiencing, folks. The judgment of God is coming. So let's slow down here and talk about the people that are going to receive this, because you're saying, well, what encouragement am I going to get out of that? I hope by the Holy Spirit a lot. Look at what it says here on verse 8. Who's he taking this vengeance out of? How can you say God doesn't have the right to hate and read verses like this? It is time for the church to get out of its kiddie pool faith of what you want to believe about God instead of submitting to what God's Word says about Him actually. If God doesn't hate, then this is the worst schizophrenic known to man. Someone who can just lose his cool and have this type of vengeance out on people. But you're saying he actually loves them as he throws them in the lake of fire? Let me challenge your American theology of prosperity gospel that we've created here. You're saying it's not in the character of God for him to hate? So he dotes and loves on all the people that he's throwing into this lake of fire? Because God loves all? It's challenging, isn't it? Makes you think. Are your beliefs based on what somebody told you or what the Word of God told you? There is a day coming that the wrath of God, he will delight because it is his holiness and pure perfection, his hatred towards sin being displayed. He will be known glorious and mighty for his anger and his hatred and his wrath on sinners. God hates the idolater. It's in Psalms a couple times. It's there, church. This is why Paul started out, grace and peace to you. Grace and peace to you. Sometimes we don't have a true appreciation for something until we know what we've been saved from. Yeah, this is deep. And friends, it's fun to see our little kid put on those kiddie pool wings and go into the nursery pool. But that's not a cool sight 30 years later if they're still in the kiddie pool with those swimmies on. Quit embracing what you want to believe about God and submit what the Word of God says about God. Vengeance is coming. On Satan? Yeah. But look at verse 8. Taking vengeance with flaming fire on those who don't know God and on those who don't obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus. Two types of humans will be thrown into a lake of fire. Two types of humans will experience the judgment and wrath of God. Two types of humans will personally experience in reality what the parable of Lazarus and the rich man was about, of a rich man being in torment, crying out, begging and pleading for someone to go and share the gospel with his loved ones. Two types of people will experience that. Church, now look at this. We're swimming deep now, remember? Okay? We're not in knee-deep water. We're swimming deeper. Look at it. Who will get this vengeance? Two types of people. Those who don't know God and those who don't obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus. And those who disobey the gospel, but also those that don't know God. What's that mean, Chris? Romans chapter 1. Look at it. For God's wrath is revealed from heaven against all godlessness and unrighteousness of people who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. Since what can be known about God is evident among them because God has shown it to them. For his invisible attributes, that is, his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly seen since the creation of the world, being understood through what he has made. As a result, people are without excuse. Chapter 3 of Romans says this in verse 10. As it is written, there is no one righteous, not even one. There is no one who understands. There is no one who seeks God. All have turned away and all alike have become useless. There is no one who does good, not even one. Two human beings will face the judgment and wrath of God. What does the Word of God say in 2 Thessalonians? It will be one that disobeyed the gospel message. But who else will it be, church? Those that don't know God. Romans 10:17 says that salvation only comes by faith, and that faith only comes through the message of Jesus Christ. That means that there are people in this world who, like you, had no power or control over where they were born and what continent they were born on. They will grow up like you with family and friends. They will walk this earth never hearing of Christianity or church. They will never hear Jesus. And the American false gospel will say, well, God will give them a second chance. They didn't get a chance to hear about Jesus. But the gospel message, according to Romans, says creation itself will be their judgment, their judge. Will judge their actions. They, like you, choose a self-absorbed life to make it around them. Why? Because, friends, none of us seek God. None of us want God. And Paul is just saying there are two types of people that's going to get this judgment. Those who disobey the gospel, that hear it and say no. But friend, also the one that never heard. Who wants to worship a God like that? And I would say to you, why would God even give us a chance? If you understand your sinfulness and wretchedness, you can never get out of your mouth, why would God give me, why would God even do anything else besides judge me? The question is, why won't he allow everybody into heaven? The question is, why is he letting any of us? That's the scandal. And so yet that brings us to the mission of the church. That brings it all into focus. What the heck we're doing here. Why we're left. What purpose we have in life. What are the resources that God's given us. And the energy that time and God gives us, what all that's supposed to be used for. Because, friend, according to this passage, the church can only have impact on one of these two people. We have no control over the one that rejects the gospel, right? Because man can't save man, amen? It's not by human will or a father's decision, but it's by the birth of God. John chapter 1. Okay? Read it. It's there. It's up to God and that man whether or not he gets saved. I can't do that. I don't have control over that. But what do I do have control over? That I can declare the greatness and goodness and mercy of God in the gospel message of Jesus Christ to all those that God puts me in encounter with and opens that door. I can't save people, and I can't influence their salvation, but what I do have control over is, did they hear the message before they left this world? Will I let my entire life be devoted to proclaiming the priority of the urgency of the message of the gospel that there is hope, that judgment is coming, and it's going to be horrible, but God has provided a way out through His Son Jesus? Are we going to declare that? Are we going to wrap our lives around it? Or have you forgotten what you have been saved from? Grace and peace to you, church. Grace and peace to you. What excuse can you muster up that can say to God, I won't go take that same grace and peace to someone else? I know it's not in my control. I know I can't dictate. But if there's a household out there that hasn't heard the gospel message, no, I can do something about that. This is why there's missions. This is why there's an embracing of the sovereignty of God, but also an embracing of the mission of God. Because how can we hold back what we didn't earn ourselves? And how can we hold back when we didn't initiate the avenue in which it came to us? You're here because someone else was obedient to the declaration and proclamation of the gospel. And that's all we got control over. But if you believe in a false American gospel that says you had some credit by you walking down an aisle or you praying a prayer, than you can possibly justify why you don't have to go. When you make it a man's made work gospel where I did something to get my salvation, then you can justify why you earned it over them. But when it has been embedded and rooted in the grace and the peace that God has sovereignly bestowed upon you, you are without excuse, church. And there are people that will be judged because they haven't known God. They didn't even hear the gospel. Why would Jesus do it? My friends, Jesus has already done his part. You get it? He came out of the grave. He made the peace. He was the grace, and he was the peace. And get this, he didn't leave you stranded. He put his heart in your heart. This is what he said when he said to you, what you see here, disciples, you'll see even greater than these. Even what we're doing right now, you'll see even greater. Why? Because the Spirit of God would be in the church. And it would move because the people were obedient to the gospel. What excuse can you give not to pray and beg, be a beggar of God for lost souls? What excuse can you give to not be a giver to the missional endeavor of proclaiming the gospel to the nations? And what excuse can you give not to be submissive to discipleship to where you can be a proclaimer of the word of God and the gospel? Friends, you've got no excuse. And if you stand here today and say you do, then you're not even on the same page with us, friend. What are we doing when this is the reality? What are we stinking doing? We got to secure our homes. We got to secure our way of living. We got to make sure that our kids get a part of the right rec clubs and travel teams. We got to make sure that our kid gets to fulfill their dreams. What good are those dreams when this is the reality? Huh? I mean, that's dumb. It's futile. Oh, I think Paul had a word for that. Rubbish. I consider all these things worth rubbish compared to knowing the glory and the greatness of God. Yeah. Probably our problem is we're not staying from daybreak to noon. In the Word of God, know these things. We got our 1-minute devotionals and our 5-minute devotionals and our 20-minute sermonettes and sermons, and it's Thanksgiving holidays. These people like to leave, Chris. And we're all consumed about where we got to go next so we can catch our NFL football games or that we can get our God-forsaken nap, that God's giving you the very breath you're breathing right there while you're sleeping. You don't even know how you're doing it, but he's doing it in you. Why the heck is he doing all this, folks? It's not for your stinking glory. It's for the glory of God. And the fact that there is a day of judgment coming, and his righteousness and faithfulness is going to be seen by the saints, and the saints are going to glorify the greatness of God. But there are going to be two people groups that don't experience that. They experience something we can't even describe. And all he's doing is telling us to proclaim the same grace and peace that you walked in under. What are we doing? God is so patient. Now let's start listening, church, to his heart. Verse 11, and in view of this, we always pray for you that God, our God, will consider you worthy of his calling, and will by his power fulfill every desire for goodness and the work of faith, so that the name of our Lord Jesus will be glorified by you and you by him, according to the grace of our God and Lord Jesus Christ. Let's Paul's saying here. And I'm going to continue to pray that the glory of God maxes out in your life. That what is evident in your life is that you hold to the truths and that your whole ambition is for God to be bragged about. May through my life, may God be bragged about. That's why we're here. To be braggers of God. That's why we submit and deny ourselves, because we've been offered something so much more glorious. He's going to make his glory be made known in us. He's going to let us share in his inheritance. His inheritance. He's going to let us be partakers. Grace and peace to you, Church of Bridge Community. Grace and peace. Grace and peace. Grace and peace are yours. You had a bad week? Grace. It's yours. A little nervous about things coming up in the future? Peace. Biggest thing about your future has already been taken care of. Grace and peace to you, church. Now get over yourself. Get about the gospel. Get about the glory of God. Be braggers of God and what he has done.